right. Anyway, in case of sickness, the cause should be ascertained. Meaning find out why you are sick. Look into yourself and see what you are doing. Unhelpful conditions should be changed. Wrong habits corrected. Then nature is to be assisted. Nature. In her effort to expel impurities and to reestablish right conditions in the system.
Amen.
That's the definition of disease. And what Jonathan said is correct, because most of us think that's what disease is. Did you sick or you ill? But it's more to that, as we know now, that we have done something. Not in all cases, but the majority of the time, we have done something that has caused us to be sick. And that's why she says, ascertain the cause. All right, what's the definition of health? Well, let me ask it this way. Was a health reform before Ellen White had her vision?
Yes.
Janet's saying yes. Ellis is saying what now?
Inside the church?
Well, health reform in general. Was a health reform message in the Bible before Sister White gave her message, her vision?
Yes.
It was. It's always been. Where?
Genesis.
Where else?
Leviticus.
Where else?
1 Corinthians 10:31.
There's always been a health reform. Think about the Israelites. They were brought out into the wilderness, and what were they fed?
Manna.
God was trying to bring them back.
And water.
Yeah, bread and water. It was a training session for them to get their minds re-educated because they had been in Egypt too long. Now, next question. What is medical missionary work?
Helping people with their health.
Helping people with their health. That's not exactly what I'm looking for, but but it's part of it.
Using it as the,
it's health.
You can't tell. Flat out helping people was what Janet said. You have anything to back that up? From the scripture.
The whole scripture. Yeah. Isaiah 58?
She's correct. The medical missionary work is in Isaiah 58. And sometimes we overlook it. Most people think the medical missionary work is a lifestyle center, like Yuchi Pines or Wildwood. And a lot of people say, I can't do the medical missionary work because I cannot afford to go to these schools. But that's not the medical missionary work. It is feeding the hungry, clothing the naked. If someone is depressed and they just need to talk to somebody, it could be simply babysitting for Anna or DeMario if they have to do something. Taking care of someone who has Alzheimer's and being a caretaker to them. That's the medical missionary work, serving people, and that's what Christ did all day long. Now, I guess you're wondering why I'm talking about all these things, because we're going to see today that there's a divine prescription for our character development. And I'm proposing that that divine prescription has something to do with health reform and the medical missionary work. And I know that's my passion. And I'm very sad because I travel a lot and I'm in different churches. And I don't care if it's an independent church and I don't care if it's a conference church. It's usually the same. I don't see the health message being done. I don't see the medical missionary work being done. And my issue is whether or not these things that we're not doing will affect our salvation.
Amen.
So I'm asking you right now to keep an open mind and think for yourself and check me out. We may not be able to finish this entire presentation, that's okay. But I wanted to plant the thought. You need to see if these two things are important enough for us to put into our lives, especially if it deals with our salvation. All right, Christy, I think we can go to, and let me tell you, yeah, we can go to the next slide.
Okay.
God's character is on trial. We talked a little bit about this last night. And the thing is, why is God on trial to begin with?
He was accused.
He was accused by Satan. And this is war going on in heaven. And Satan portrays God as a tyrant. He says he's not loving. He's self-serving. And that there's no way that anybody can keep his law. But God says there is somebody that can keep his law perfectly. And we are that somebody. But unfortunately, are we actually living up to all the requirements that God wants us to do? And God promises us we don't have to do this by ourselves. No. He will give us the power as long as we're obedient. But he is on trial before the universe. Now the universe, they saw what Satan did to Jesus. Satan murdered Jesus, we know that. And so the universe is all right with that because they saw Satan's true character. But what they're concerned about is us. Because sin originated in heaven. How it originated, no one knows. But for us on this earth, we have wallowed in sin all day long. We have done everything that we could possibly do to be sinful. And the universe is still watching and thinking, is God's judgment correct? Is he going to let these crazy people on this earth who's committed all kinds of sins to come up to heaven? Is this controversy going to start all over again? They may not want us there. And that's what God's trying to do. So what God did, he says, I'm going to resolve this conflict. I'm going to give Satan the opportunity to prove his point. Because Satan was saying, I can run the universe better than God can run the universe. My government will not be a tyrannical government. That's his warped thinking. But that's what he was thinking about doing. And God says, okay, here's the earth. Go down to the earth, and let's see how your plan is going to work. Now, God could have done what? When all this rebellion happened, he could have destroyed Satan right there on the spot. And that would have been just. But in his mercy, he wanted this whole plan to be carried through so this issue could finally be stopped. And unfortunately, we're the pawns involved in this. And some of us in this room are willingly participating in Satan's snares, whether we know it or not. Next slide. You can keep going because I already talked about the issues. All right. Ezekiel 36:23. God says he will sanctify his name, or he will sanctify his own character. Because we have profaned it among the heathens, but he's going to take us, turn us around to his divine power, and we're going to be a witness to the heathens that God is true. Next slide. God's way of resolving the conflict. In order to destroy sin and its results, he gave his best beloved. Who's his best beloved? It's Christ. And again, he's put it in our power to cooperation with him to bring the scene of misery to an end. And it needs to come to an end one way or the other. I mean, this is it. Chris, we can go to the next slide. I think I've already done that one too. Okay. This plan of salvation we have, we always talk about the plan of salvation. I always thought it was about me. The plan of salvation is just about Elaine. Well, no, it's not. It is really about God. And this is why it should be our highest motivation to vindicate God's character before the universe. And how is it possible to vindicate his character? We ought to establish that Satan's charges against God are disproven. That God's not a tyrant. He's a God of love. And his law that we're supposed to keep is an expression of that love, and it's divine. It's a divine government. The key is we have to totally surrender ourselves to him to keep his commandments. Amen. And Sister White says in Faith and Works, page 42, God will have a people up on this earth who will vindicate his honor by having respect of all his commandments. The question is today, do we have respect for all of his commandments? But he's going to have a people, and it may not be Seventh-day Adventists, because there are statements from her saying that we may end up losing our crown, and others will come in and take our place. Amen. And I don't want that to happen to me. Now, evidence that this plan of salvation is God-centered, God has told us in his word, this is all about me. Isaiah 43:25-26. I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for my own sake, and will not remember thy sins. Put in remembrance, let us plead together. Declare thou that thou mayest be justified. It's for his own sake. We're kind of like secondary, but it's for his own sake because he has to vindicate his character before the universe. He's using us to do that. I took a commentary from Albert Barnes. He was a theologian during the time period of Sister White. And I wanted to get more specific on this for my own sake. Not because you deserve it, Elaine, or have any claim to it, Elaine, or that it would not be right to punish you, not even primarily to promote your happiness and salvation, but for my sake, to show, what's God want to show? The benevolence of his character and to promote his glory by your forgiveness and salvation. So this plan of salvation is bigger than what we thought. God is first, we're second, but we have a really serious part to play in this. The final demonstration of what the gospel can do in and for humanity is still to come. Christ showed the way by taking a human body, because Christ came down here in the same body that we have, and he did not sin. So what is our excuse? Especially since he's given us his power to overcome the sin. We are to follow his example and prove that what God did in Christ, he can do in every human being who submits to him. And that's the key. We're not submitting. If we would submit to him totally, he can change us. The universe, remember the universe that thinks we're crazy and that doesn't want us to come to heaven? The universe is awaiting this demonstration. And when it has been accomplished, the end will come. God will have fulfilled his plan. He will have shown himself true and Satan a liar. And God's government will stand vindicated.
Amen.
Now here we are. I'm dressed for court today because I'm a witness, okay? And we all need to be dressed for court and changing our characters because we are the witnesses for God. And God tells us that in Isaiah 43:9-11. I came across this by when I was doing a study, and it's been probably been about a year ago. And I thought, Lord, I'm supposed to be a witness for you. What kind of witness am I? And it says, ye are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servant, whom I have chosen. Who is the servant that he chose? That's Christ. Christ was a witness to the character of his Father. We are to be a witness to the character of God. And he says, that ye may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me, there was no God formed. So folks, we are probably the deal breaker here, possibly. And Satan is going to wage an all-out attack. And I know, I'm not trying to think like Satan. I just read something that makes sense to me, what somebody else has said. Once, if everybody becomes like God and the character is perfected, we know he's going to die. He will never exist again. So he's trying to prolong this. So if he can get as many of us not to have our characters developed, he can live a little bit longer. That was the logic that somebody used. And that kind of makes sense because he's out full-fledged declaring war on God's people. Let's go to the next slide. Revelation 12:12 tells us his time is short. If you know that you only have a certain amount of time to do something, what do you usually do? You hurry. Yeah, you want to hurry and accomplish their goal because your time is running out. Well, that's exactly what he's doing. He wants to accomplish his goal because his time is running out. And so the attacks are going to be more fierce as we get towards the end. He will release an arsenal of weapons against God's commandment-keeping people. And they will be fierce. And that war is raging right now. And you can tell yourself because each one of us has a war inside of us. We battle against right and wrong. We may want to do something we know is wrong, but then on the other hand, we think we got to do what's right. And so you got these conflicting feelings going on in your own body. But Satan, he's raging this war. And in the time of war, what's the first thing you want to destroy? Anyway. The enemy, but how? Who said headquarters? A little bit more specific.
The leader.
Not the leaders.
But the
The defenses is getting closer. Somebody said it. Somebody said it, I think.
Communications.
Communications. That's right. You want to destroy the communication. Why?
Chaos without it.
Thank you. It is chaos without it. So that's Satan's strategy. Now, where is our communication center in the spiritual warfare?
Brain.
Where?
Your brain.
The brain. Any particular portion of the brain?
Frontal lobe.
Frontal lobe. You're in nursing, right? Okay. I need to come back there. Okay. All right. Next slide, because I'm gonna talk to her. Okay. Now, I caution you in the beginning. I'm a medical missionary in learning. Okay. So some of these things I'm learning also with you, and I'm just sharing them with you. The frontal lobe is in right behind our eyes in the forehead. And that's where we're going to be sealed.
Right.
And there's a quote from Sister White about Satan's forehead. You remember it, anybody?
Yeah.
Sunken in.
From non-use.
For what now?
From non-use.
From non-use. Is sunken in? Satan's is sunken in for non-use? Wow, that's a dangerous thought.
I just thought she said
it was high and noble.
Yes.
I remember saying that it was high.
But his countenance has changed.
It was high and noble when he was Lucifer. But his countenance has changed, and his forehead has sunk, which makes me think there's something wrong with his frontal lobe. All right, next slide. What takes place in the frontal lobe? And when I saw this, the first thing I thought about was God implanted in us from the very beginning a perfect character. And he included these different things in there so we could function. It's a seat of worship. So why wouldn't Satan want to attack the frontal lobe? That's what we worship God. And you know what? It doesn't just apply to our God that we know, the true God, but anybody can worship anything. It's still there. If you want to worship Buddha, if you want to worship a dog, if you want to worship a chicken, whatever, it's still, your seat of worship is still in the frontal lobe. And that's where your conscience is. And your character. And your personality. This is where we experience convictions for right or wrong. And redirect inappropriate behavior. This is where we reason and plan and organize and focus and concentrate. And I'm having a hard time with that today, and I'm going to tell you why when we get to the slide, okay? And exercise self-restraint. And then I learned, I think it was from Dr. Timothy Jennings, I believe. He's a Seventh-day Adventist psychiatrist in Chattanooga, Tennessee. But there's a special part of the frontal cortex, and you might want to help me here, called the anterior cingulate cortex. It is our neurological heart. I did not know that. It is here we experience love, compassion, empathy, sympathy, altruism, and the ACC is also the seat of the will, the place where we choose right from wrong.
Amen.
This is what God put in us in the beginning. And when I think about this, I think about the medical missionary work, and I think about Isaiah 58, because to do the medical missionary work, to really interact with people who may not be that intelligent. Because we watched a young man last night, DeMar was witnessing too, and it seemed like he had some issues. You remember?
Yeah.
But that's, to me, that's a medical missionary work. He's willing to do a Bible study with him, knowing his limitations. But he was compassionate. He didn't make fun of him. And those traits are in us, those character traits are in us for that reason. Because God wants us to serve people. Next slide. Now, the spirit of prophecy confirms what I just said. She says the brain nerves, which communicate with the entire system, are the only medium. There is no other medium, okay? This is the only medium through which heaven can communicate to man and affect his inmost life. And whatever disturbs the circulation of the electric currents in the nervous system lessens the strength of the vital powers, and the result is a deadening of the sensibilities of the mind. Okay. Intemperance. somebody told me temperance was self-control. Intemperance then is not in control. And she says it would benumb the perceptive organs and weaken the brain nerve power, that eternal things are not appreciated. So if we're intemperate, and you know that you're intemperate or not, I don't know. Because the thing about character is, there's a difference between character and reputation. Now somebody can say, you know, Elaine has a wonderful character. She does this, she does that. But see, Elaine's true character is in the dark, when she's at home by herself and no one can see her. That's how you can distinguish the true character. What you see now, you don't really know who I am, but God does. And you know, it's kind of sad too, because we have met people and thought, I cannot believe they did such a horrible thing. They were such a good man. No, they had a good reputation, but not necessarily the character of God.
Character or integrity.
Character or integrity. She says, the higher powers of the mind designed for elevated purposes are brought into slavery to the baser passions. And we're going to find out where it is in our brain that brings in those baser passions. And if our physical habits are not right, our mental and moral powers cannot be strong, because there's sympathy between the physical and the moral. Now this is the limbic system. Is it limbic?
Limbic
system that I'm talking about. Because we're going to find what happens to the person when the frontal lobe is compromised, and this system has something to do with it. Okay. Now, this frontal lobe, people like to think it's cold because it's analytical. But we just learned it's not just analytical. It also has the mercy and compassion and all those wonderful things in it. But this is a part of our being that keeps us socially graceful, rule-abiding, and capable of conforming to civil order. So, as long as this is in place, we know how to act as society. But if it's removed, we're going to pick up some of the animal passions. Now, this limbic system is called the hot seat. And it says the brain has two distinct but integrated systems that facilitate a balance between balance or imbalance in our mind. This limbic system deals with the emotions a lot. And so it serves as a type of hot area of the brain. And this part of our brain can cause an inner sense of doom and gloom and set off the fight or flight reaction. And it's called hot because of its emotionality that can also be impulsive and get us in trouble. Now, I'm giving an example. Don and Janet would come up for camp meeting and somebody cut Don off. And he almost had an accident. I'm sure, you know, the adrenaline was pumping because it frightened him, okay? Now, but Don has two choices. He can get out of the car and challenge the man and they have a fist fight. Or his frontal lobe would kick in and so he'll say, I'm a Christian. I need to reason this through. I understand what the person did to me, but I'm going to forgive that person and I'm not going to let the limbic system take over. And I know that some of us in this room has probably experienced that we had this system going on, especially when we're driving. Okay, next one. The key is to have a balancing act between these two regions. And sometimes we're able to accomplish such a balance that we feel an inner sense of oneness or peace. And that's what we want to be. But a crisis can integrate these regions quickly, which is why we tend to immediately prioritize those things that are most important in our lives when a crisis comes. So if I'm sitting down eating my dinner and I'm hungry, and all of a sudden Granny Ann needs to go to the hospital, well, I could still sit there and eat my dinner, but no. It's like, that's not important, you know, it's something that can wait. You go to the hospital. All right, I'll go back one more. The goal needs to be to get to such an integration without the crisis. If our alarm system does not turn off, if it does not turn off, our immune system is impaired and our prefrontal cortex becomes paralyzed. Stress keeps you going, and if you're constantly thinking about negative things, and believe me, I'm not preaching to the choir because I know about stress. And my thoughts would get to running, and I would give you a good example that happened about 2 years ago. I thought I had passed the school bus. I stopped, but I thought I had passed the school bus. And my mind got to working. They're going to come and take me to jail. It is a felony. It's a felony. It's a felony to pass the school bus. And I was in Georgia. And I was like, Lord, what am I going to do? They're going to come and take me. They've had my license plate number. And I'm visiting my niece. And what my niece didn't tell me was that her husband was on probation. So about an hour later, somebody knocks on the door with a gun in tow. And I was like, Lord, I guess I'm going to jail, but I'm not going to worry about it anymore. But that's what happens. And if you keep doing that and worrying about things, it is going to impair your immune system, and it's going to shut down that frontal lobe. And that's what stress does. Okay. Now, this man is Phineas Gage. And has anybody heard of Phineas Gage?
Yeah.
Many have. Okay. Well, we have a 5-minute video clip that I want to show.
150 years ago, became one of the most celebrated cases in the history of medicine, which is why he's still here in the Warren Museum at Harvard Medical School. A smart, likable young man, according to his friends. Phineas was working as the foreman of a railroad construction gang in Vermont when a blasting accident blew this 3-foot-long iron rod through his left cheek and clear through the top of his head. The rod landed about 25 yards behind him. And Phineas got to his feet and walked away. As a local newspaper put it the next day, the most singular circumstance connected with this melancholy affair is that he is alive and in full possession of his senses and free of pain. But while he lived another 12 years with part of his brain destroyed, he was, as his friend said, no longer Gage. He was described as fitful and grossly profane. On the one hand, impatient and obstinate, and on the other, unable to make plans for the future. Unable, in fact, to make up his mind. Phineas Gage's fame stems not only from his simply surviving such a ghastly accident, but because he was the first patient to suggest a link between personality and the functions of the front part of the brain, the frontal lobes. In this show, we're going to explore how our frontal lobes shape who we are and how we go about our lives. What's the area of the brain that was affected during this accident?
Well, I think the area that everybody focuses on is the frontal lobes. Now, there might have been some damage to areas a little bit outside the frontal lobes, but what makes this person and their case interesting to scientists is the fact that the injury was in the frontal lobes, and as a result of the injury, Gage's personality changed.
Can we tell what kind of personality? I mean, was it an inability to make decisions? It's hard to tell.
It's hard to tell. Other than the fact we know it changed, he couldn't resume his former position.
Yeah.
Although he did work afterwards. I mean,
but he wasn't good as a foreman.
He wasn't good as a foreman, which requires executive skills.
I brought a brain in a box here, and I wonder if you can show me where on the brain the accident affected him.
So these are the frontal lobes of the brain. This is the right side and the left side. And the rod probably entered somewhere from the bottom of the frontal lobes on the left side and came out somewhere on the top of the frontal lobes. Mm-hmm. So all the tissue in between here to here, no doubt, 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 no doubt.
In those days about the relationship of the brain to the personality.
Yeah.
How did they organize their thoughts about that?
Well, there wasn't a lot of sophisticated thinking. Here's an example of such thinking. This is a phrenology skull, and you can see etched into the skull in different places are what might be called faculties.
Phrenology was invented by a very bright fellow called Franz Joseph Gall, who thought that different parts of the brain did different things. His mistake was in believing bumps in the skull reveal what lies beneath. Has any one of these areas
is going to confirm. You don't even have categories
Alan,
like this anymore.
It was a crapshoot.
Yeah. You know? I mean, benevolence. I don't think nobody's looking for benevolence in the brain.
We're all looking for benevolence, but not right now in the brain.
Reasoning faculties he's got over here.
So that's probably not a bad place to have it. There's probably some relationship between the functions of the frontal lobe and your ability to do certain kinds of reasoning.
He's got language under the left eye.
Yeah.
Is that possible? Is there... I mean, is that possible? Why would he say that? Is the brain under the left eye?
I don't know what kind of plaster cast he was studying in order to do that. There's no... Under the left eye is your left cheek.
Gall may have been wrong in the details, but his concept of the brain as an organ with specialized regions has been vindicated. And of all the specialized regions, none is more important in distinguishing us from the rest of the animal kingdom and from our pre-human ancestors than the enormously enlarged front part of our thinking brain, the frontal lobes or prefrontal cortex.
It serves as sort of the central executive, the chairman of the board of the brain, and it helps guide our behaviors. It helps us plan. It helps us carry out plans. It helps us reason about difficult topics. It helps us make certain kinds of decisions. It helps us inhibit behaviors that are not really appropriate, more primitive behaviors. For example, let's say you want to be on a diet and you love chocolate, and in front of you you see this wonderful, delicious chocolate cake, right, but you know you shouldn't have it.
Right. So the front of the back of my brain is
wants it.
Wants it, and the front of my brain
is saying, right, not good for me.
Right.
And so you're able to put it off because you have another goal. Maybe the goal is to lose weight.
Yeah.
Maybe the goal is to live longer.
Right.
So these goals are going to be much more important than this sort of short-term goal based on just seeing that chocolate cake,
right,
in front of you.
Okay. I just want to summarize what we talked about so far. The battlefield is over the mind, and the only medium which heaven can communicate with man is in our mind. Satan wants to destroy the communication center to discredit us, God's witnesses. And God wants to protect the communication center and establish his character in his people. We are God's witnesses to vindicate his character before the universe, and demonstrating that God's law is holy and can be kept and is safe to take us to heaven. An impairment of the frontal lobe affects our character. Next slide. And I just have a question for you. Is it all about Elaine? Or is it all about God? Am I selfish? Or am I going to be self-denying? Now, these are the results of an impaired or paralyzed frontal lobe. And if you see any of these things in yourself, you may want to consider praying like I do for the Lord to give me the victory over these things. Impaired moral principles, social impairment, you don't want to deal with anybody. Indifference, lack of foresight, loss of abstract reasoning, you can't plan or organize. Memory impairment, you can't remember where you put your keys, that's why I said it's probably me. All right. Distractibility. You ever talk to someone and they get so distracted and finally you just walk away? Restless, emotional instability, lack of initiative, boasting, hostility, aggressive behavior. If we see any of these things in ourselves, chances are that we have something going on and we have impaired our frontal lobe. It's doing something to ourselves. Okay. And this is what Satan uses to destroy our frontal lobe. Remember, his time is short, and he knows exactly what he's doing because he knows about God's creation, which is man, and he's going to take the things that God created and use it, and I'm going to show you his own statement, okay? He takes the things that God's created to use against us. Food, sugar, caffeine, drugs, prescription drugs, illegal drugs, lack of exercise, lack of water, lack of rest, stress, nicotine, television, music, and competition. And I'm going to tell you right now, in the homes I've been in, I've seen the sugar, I've seen the caffeine when I was traveling, I've seen the television with violent programs on it. And these are generational Seventh-day Adventists.
Amen.
I've seen the music and the competition I laugh about, because I had an elder in my church in Ohio, and Maurice and the other men would get together and play basketball, and he was telling me about the stories. I mean, they were just playing basketball just to be friendly with one another, but they broke out into a fight. Okay? So I'm not so sure if it's good to be playing basketball or anything else, because it deals with competition and everybody wants to win. It's a character development issue. But what do you notice here? What do you notice? What did God give us to keep us out of this trap that we're not following? The eight laws of health. God gave us the eight laws of health that would counter these things here if we follow them. Okay. We've already got the definition of food, because we talked about that earlier. But there's two texts, Ecclesiastes 10:17. It talks about eat in due season for strength, not for drunkenness. And if you overeat, you're just like a drunk. Ezekiel 16:49 was the sins of Sodom. And what did she do? They had pride, they had plenty of food, and comfortable security, but didn't support the poor and needy. And in this, what do you see? What principle do you see in this? Anyone? They didn't support the poor and needy. What is that?
Medical
missionary work. Okay. This is the food that God gave us, to the left. This is the food we enjoy to eat, if we be honest with ourselves, okay? That's the junk food, that's the living food. Now, here's a quote from Satan. This should cause everybody to start thinking about this. Satan gathered the fallen angels together to devise some way of doing the most possible evil to the human family. One proposition after another was made, till finally Satan himself thought of a plan. He would take the fruit of the vine, also wheat, and other things given by God as food, and would convert them into poisons, which would ruin man's physical, mental, and moral powers, and so overcome the senses that Satan would have full control over what? The mind, because he cannot place his thoughts in our mind. Only God can do that. But if you surrender your mind to him by going along with his strategies, he can now implant his thoughts in your mind. Under the influence of liquor, men would be led to commit crimes of all kinds. Through perverted appetite, the world would be made corrupt. By leading men to drink alcohol, Satan would cause them to descend lower and lower in the scale. He is trying to get us to the baser passions back here. And that's what we just saw when we saw the clip. Back here is not a good place to be all the time. There's supposed to be that balance. And we're out of balance when the frontal lobe is paralyzed. Next slide. I came across this about a couple of months ago, and it frightened me, okay? This is from To Be Like Jesus, page 214, paragraph 2. Happiness, I'll just go to the bottom line here. Let me go in a little bit further. Let's see. I better read it all. Happiness must be sought in the right way and from the right source. Some think they may surely find happiness in the course of indulgence in simple pleasures or in deceptive worldly attractions. And some sacrifice physical and moral obligations, thinking to find happiness, and they lose both soul and body. Others will seek their happiness in the indulgence of an unnatural appetite and consider the indulgence of taste more desirable than health and life. Many suffer themselves to be enchained by sensual passions and will sacrifice. They will sacrifice their physical strength, their intellect, and their moral powers to the gratification of lust. And they will bring themselves to untimely graves, and in the judgment, they will be charged with self-murder. So do not tell me that God is pleased with us when we do something to this body. This is his temple where he wants to dwell. That's what we're going to be. If we don't change, that's what we're going to be. And we can say, oh, Lord, Lord, did I do this in your name? Did I do that in your name? He's going to say, depart from me, I never knew you. Next slide. This is the junk food. It affects the hypothalamus in your brain, and that's the part of the brain that governs hunger and thirst. And studies have shown that regular fast food consumption leads to brain shrinkage. Satan is using the food. And also, junk food can get you high. Did you know that? You don't have to have drugs. Just eat a lot of junk food. Same principle. Because it releases something called dopamine. And so that's the same kind of thing as releasing people who are addicted to drugs.
Illegal. Same result, too.
Same result. It's no different. These meat analogs. And I feel ashamed because our church, the Seventh-day Adventist Church, is involved in Worthington and the Choppers and stuff like this. These things, and I lost my, they have, is it neurotransmitters in them? No, neurotoxins. It has neurotoxins, but also neurotoxins. And they will kill off your brain cells. So if this is a, if this is your regimen of how you eat all, and I'm talking about TVP, what else, Christy, what else is there?
Well, all the little burgers.
The burgers, yeah, this
isolates.
Those are poison. And I didn't grow up as a Seventh-day Adventist. I grew up in a Baptist Methodist environment. And I ate everything. I had chitlins, I ate pig feet, nose, sow's meat, okay, all that stuff. So I was ignorant, I didn't know. And when I became a Seventh-day Adventist and transitioning off of the meat, I went directly to the analogs. Yeah. And I probably would have stayed at the analogs if I didn't keep getting educated. Yeah. But that's what's, I mean, it's nothing but poison. I hate to say that because we're the ones that's producing it. Yeah. Next slide. Now, I was also a junk food cheese. I love cheese. Sister White says cheese should never be introduced into the stomach. Period. It is more objectionable. It is wholly unfit for food. And folks, that includes pizzas. That includes mozzarella cheese. If it's a soft cheese, it doesn't apply. But there's a reason why she said that. And it's because there is some type of chemical, a component in the cheese called tyramine, and it can cross the blood-brain barrier and get into the cells, and it acts as a false neutral transmitter. And so it stimulates cells that shouldn't even be stimulated, and it can confuse the brain, and it can confuse the frontal lobe. And that's why, and this is coming from one of us. This is coming from Dr. Neil Neely at Weimar Institute. How many have heard of Dr. Neely? Yeah. All right, he's an MD. This is what he's saying about cheese, not Elaine, all right? Yeah, it's, yeah, this is what he's saying. It should never, and Sister White already said it before Dr. Neely was even born, probably. She already said it, because God revealed it to her. Sugar. I frequently sit down to the tables of the brethren and sisters and see that they use a great amount of milk and sugar. These clog the system, irritate the digestive organs, and affect the brain. And from the light given me, sugar, when largely used, is more what? So we go in and we look at people eating meat and we say, you know, look at that person. They're over eating that chicken and all that stuff, and we're criticizing them and we're eating all their sugar. So we can't criticize anybody. We need to be educated because our lives are at stake, but more important, God's character is at stake, because if we keep this up, he's not going to have any witnesses, except for those who are going to come in and take our place. Let me read something also. Dr. Neil Netley talks about large amounts of sugar in the diet will impair frontal lobe functions in school-aged children. That should frighten you enough. You want to know why these kids are running around like they're crazy? It's because of what they're eating. And the research shows today that your children, your grandchild, Annika, Ashley, your grandchildren, they will not live longer than their parents. Because of the way they're eating, they're not exercising, they're on these computers all day long. This is this is Satan. And if we really wanted to have our lives like they're supposed to be, especially the children, it really bothers me about the children. They're even losing their teeth. Over here in Welch, I had a client. I used to work as an attorney, and I was in the child abuse and neglect area. I had a little boy who was 5 years old. They hardly didn't have any teeth. They were all rotten. You want to know why they were rotten? Because
sugar.
Giving them Pepsis to drink.
Give them Pepsi in a baby bottle.
In a baby bottle. And they lose all their teeth.
Yeah.
So we don't have any business. And you know, the body cannot take all that sugar. The brain cannot take all that sugar. It can take the sugar that comes in the natural package, but not the sugar that we're dumping in. And you know what? The average American eats about 150 to 170 pounds of sugar. Her son and I did a health fair we went to. We actually had a wheelbarrow of stuff that looked like sugar, and we showed people how much sugar was in these things that they were eating. And then you hand it to them and said, would you like to eat it this way? And it's like, no. And if this doesn't get to you, then I'm done, okay? This is a PET brain scan. And it shows how a person reacts in the same way to sugar as they do cocaine. The same area that lights up with cocaine lights up with sugar. But that's not enough to convince you to stop eating the sugar.
Amen.
This is from Dr. Amen. And I think it's also, yeah, this is from Dr. Hyman. Think cocaine is bad for your brain? Then you might want to change the way you think about sugar. Eating high sugar foods lights up your brain on an MRI, I'm thinking about air back here, like a Christmas tree.
Is that why it's so
light? Mm-hmm. Yeah. He said the part of the brain that lights up is the very same part of the brain that's triggered by cocaine or heroin. That's the effect of sugars. And this is your brain on caffeine.
On what?
Caffeine. Some of us are still drinking pops. We're drinking sodas. And they have caffeine in them. And they have sugar in them. And then you wonder why you're sick. I have a really dear friend. And I just saw her before I came here. She's not an Adventist. My friend used to be my size. Now she's close to about 350 pounds. And what she eats almost every day, or drinks every day, is Pepsi. She can't drink water, according to her. And I told her, I said, I'm willing to help you. No, Joyce, that's okay. And I said, well, you know, Pookie, I said, I don't want to have to come to your funeral. She said, I just want you to sing at my funeral.
It's a choice.
But see, she doesn't know. She's not educated. So I can understand that. But we're educated, at least we should be, even if somebody has not taught us directly. There's so much information out there. Why not go and check the Spirit of Prophecy? Go online like I do and see what you can find. We have people within this movement like Dr. Netley and Dr. Jennings and also the folks at Amazing Discoveries, Jeannie and Rudy Davis. They're all talking about this health, and why we won't listen, it's just amazing to me. But she says, the stimulating drink, diet and drink of this day are not conducive to the best state of health. Tea. You know, we think that tea is not a problem. Tea has caffeine in it, unless you're drinking some herbal tea. And some of the herbal tea has caffeine in it also. Coffee and tobacco are all stimulating and contain poisons. They are not only unnecessary, but harmful and should be discarded if we would add to knowledge temperance. There we go with the temperance again that we talked about early on when we started. Okay, Chrissy. I've seen this, and I'm guilty of this. Before I moved here, this was in 2007, and actually, I'm guilty of Anna, because she was with me then, and I was watching TV. And she started watching TV, the shows I like to watch, I Love Lucy, Andy Griffin, and all that stuff. And I thought about it. I said, some of the things that I used to do probably came from I Love Lucy, but I didn't know. I was being deceptive in some things because that's what that show teaches you.
Yeah.
But with the children, I had to keep Brianna one day. Brianna at the time was probably about 2 or 3 years old. And Brianna could scream. Oh, she could scream. And I was babysitting. And I knew that she watched SpongeBob, because that's what she watched at home. I didn't know any better. So SpongeBob is not a cartoon. No cartoons, period. But I turned on SpongeBob, and Brianna was quiet for the entire time. Why? She was hypnotized. We're hypnotizing our children, and we're hypnotizing ourselves when we sit in front of a television set that has no redeeming qualities at all unless you're watching a documentary. I mean, not even news, because we're told to protect our senses. When we see things, I mean, I have to watch the internet. I was trying to do some research, and all of a sudden, these porno pictures pop up. And I was actually going on a site for a lifestyle center, and these pictures pop up. All these temptations are out here, and we're supposed to train our children in the garden, let them be outside, not on these computers all the time.
And cell phones.
And the cell phones.
Video games, Facebook.
Social media. Next slide, Christy. Rock music mouse. If you don't think music doesn't have an effect on the brain, it definitely does. And they did an experiment, and they had to end up stopping the experiment because the mice started killing each other. We're supposed to listen to that. You can listen to classical music that doesn't have that syncopated beat to it. Our hymns. But, you know, there's a, what's the guy's name that did the...
Christian Bernal.
Yeah, Christian Bernal. I had to stop watching him. I mean, he's real intense, but he talked about the history of music, starting from Africa and bringing it forward, and showed all the pitfalls in that. But he made this comment, and it was true. He says, some of you will not be able to watch this all the way. And he was right, because I was one of those people. Because I remember in college, the music gets to playing, you get to dancing, and everything else goes along with the rest of the story. That's why Satan has these things in our way. Because he's dealing with the base of passions. And we need to realize that the only music that should come across our ears is God's music. And unfortunately, wherever you go in the store, sometimes you have to come out of the store because they got the music playing everywhere. And it used to be that way, but now it's just more prominent. So if you listen to the music, just think about these rock music mice and how they kill each other off, and you need to get rid of the music. And this is interesting to me. Aristotle said the impact of music on shaping the character, this is all about character issues, was recognized at least 23 centuries ago. Aristotle, the famous Greek philosopher, wrote, when one listens to music that imitates a certain passion, like when I was in college, he becomes imbued with the same passion. If over a long time he habitually listens to the kind of music that rouses ignoble, degraded, or vulgar passions, his whole character will be shaped to ignoble form. In short, if one listens to the wrong kind of music, he will become the wrong kind of person. Conversely, if he listens to the right kind of music, he would tend to become the right kind of person.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.
I'm just going to tell you that lack of sleep, and that's why I said I was guilty with the keys, because I've had a lack of sleep, it will shrink your brain. And there's some research out there that shows that, but we're going to go to the next slide. How many people have been stressed?
All of us.
Stress is not a good thing to have at all. I have to find my notes on this one here. Chrissy, give me just a minute.
What is the name of the presentation?
A Divine Prescription for Character Development. You notice in this slide that there's a difference between no stress and stress. So it's actually changing the components in your brain. It's shrinking. So it's going to cause impairment. Because when you're under stress, the adrenal? Yeah, it just keeps going and going and going. And you're imagining things that haven't even happened. And so you're overloading your body. It hasn't even taken place yet. Just like the thing with the police officer I thought was going to come and arrest me. It hadn't taken place, but I was still worried about it. And I bet you everyone in here has done that. But that's what's going to happen if you continue to stress yourself out. You are impairing your frontal lobe. Competitive sports. Now, this is from Sister White. The young naturally desire activity. Our activity is supposed to be in the garden. And if they find no legitimate scope for their pent-up energies after the confinement of the schoolroom, they become restless and impatient of control, and thus are led to engage in the rude, unmanly sports that disgrace so many schools and colleges, and even to plunge into scenes of actual dissipation. Many of the youth who left their homes innocent are corrupted by their associations at school. And then I could refer to chapter after chapter the Old Testament scriptures that contain great encouragement. These scriptures are a treasure house of precious pearls, and all need them. How much time is spent by intelligent human beings in horse racing, cricket, matches, ball playing? But will indulgence in these sports give men a desire to know truth and righteousness? Will it keep God in their thoughts? Will it lead them to inquire, how is it with my soul? It won't. I don't know if anybody likes football. I never liked football, and now I have a reason not to like it even more. Those contact sports, those people are injured. Their frontal lobe is messed up, and that's why they have a lot of domestic violence taking place in their homes, because their frontal lobe has been impaired. And there was one football player, he committed suicide because he knew something was wrong with his brain, and he left instructions for them to give it to, I think, the NFL league or whatever, so they could examine his brain, because they know that this is taking place, and yet they won't stop it. People are dying in their 50s because they got this violent sports that they're involved in, and we go there and we listen to it and we cheer it on. It doesn't make sense to me, because families are being destroyed. We just see the football game, but we don't see what's going on in the homes. This is your brain on caffeine and nicotine. Now, I know most of us probably do not have nicotine in our body, but as Adventists as a whole, I bet you some of us got caffeine in there. I don't bet, because like I said, I saw it when I was in Alabama. Those who use tobacco in any form are not clear before God. It's a filthy practice. It does not glorify God in their bodies. It's a sure poison. It says God may be merciful to them while they indulge in this pernicious habit in ignorance of injury it is doing them. But when the matter is set before them and it's true light, then they are guilty before God if they continue to indulge in a gross appetite. These pictures are taken from Dr. Amen. He's Amen. He does a lot of brain scanning. He's a psychiatrist out of California. But those are dark holes. You saw what the normal brain looked like. Where do these holes come from? It's from something that we put it into our bodies. Okay, next slide. Remember, I say we're in the spiritual warfare, but the battle is not yours, but is mine. And the battle is God's. We're just his army, we're his witnesses. So either the evil angels or the angels of God are controlling the minds of men. It's all about the mind. And it would be well for us to inquire where we are standing today. And that's the question I got for you. Where are you standing today? Are you standing on God's side? Because Miss Bailey told me a long time ago, there's only two spirits. Right, Miss Bailey? There's only two. You either have the spirit of God or you have the spirit of Satan. There is no in between. We must make every preparation in our power in order to resist the enemy of souls. Every provision has been made. Every provision has been made so that man should not be left to his own finite powers to carry on the warfare against the powers of darkness. And I'm going to give these other provisions right now. Let's go. We got the missing armor, people. That is missing. Brother Jackson shared this with me when I was in Meat Ministry. Anyway, the health message for my training there is not an option. You can choose to not do it. That's fine. That's your choice. But this is part of our character development. And what are you going to take to heaven? Well, let's see how this is part of our character. True sanctification involves the whole being. It is not really possible to be partially sanctified in the sense of withholding certain areas of the life from being holy. Every department of life must be submitted to the purifying power of God's Spirit. That's in the SCA commentary. Next slide. Backsliding. She's talking about us. I am instructed. Who instructed her? I'm instructed to bear a message to all our people on the subject of health reform. For many have backslidden from their former loyalty to health reform principles. The light that God has given, who gave the light? God gave the light. It's being disregarded. A true reformation needs to take place among the believers. Go next. Did you know health message is a sacred duty? It's not, like I said, I don't think it's an option. It's a sacred duty. The body which God calls his temple should be preserved in as healthy condition as possible. Many act as though they had a right to treat their own bodies as they please. They do not realize that God has claims upon them. They are required, according to Revelation what? To glorify God. The three angels' message, thank you. They're required to glorify him in their bodies and spirits, which are his. It is a sacred duty which God has enjoined upon reasonable beings formed in his image to keep that image as perfect as possible. All, okay, are required to preserve healthy bodies and sound minds. There's a reason that God gave us the health message, and I want to tell you this. They had health reform before God gave the vision to Sister White. They had Sylvester Graham. Remember Graham crackers? All right. These were Christian folks. They also had a doctor. I think his last name was Thal or something like that. He was a regular MD. He used drugs, okay? But he decided he would see his patients get sick. So he wanted to try something different. He was doing hydrotherapy treatments and massage before Dr. Kellogg. So why would we need to get the vision of the health message? It had to be more, because they already had that in place. And these were Christian people. It's because God is trying to prepare his people for the last days. It's all about this battle. He's trying to perfect his people. A lot of times we look, I mean, what Christy and Raquel did was wonderful. But we all want to be cute, you know, because we want to lose the weight or gain weight or whatever. So this is where we are. We're like with the world with these health principles, because the world's doing it too. But this is different. There's a reason for it. And this is the rest of it. It's the light that God has given me on health reform is for our salvation and the salvation of the world. That's our high calling. The work of health reform is the Lord's means for lessening suffering in the world and for the purification of his church.
Amen.
The lack of stability in regards to the principles of health reform is a true index of their character. So don't tell me it's not about character. You can do whatever you want to do, but Elaine is convinced this is something serious, because we are in the investigative judgment time period. And now that we have been exposed to these things, you have an obligation to check it out for yourself. Don't listen to what I have to say, but everybody in here can think and they can read and they can study. Study more for yourself. Next slide. It's a test for the church. Men will be tested and tried in many ways to see if they will heed. Every church, every family needs to be instructed in regard to Christian temperance. And then it goes on to say, all should know how to eat and drink in order to preserve health. We are amid the closing scenes of this world's history, and there should be a harmonious action in the ranks of Sabbath keepers. We all should be on the same page. Okay? We cannot be on different pages. Those who stand aloof from the great work of instructing the people up on this question do not follow where the great physician leads the way. Who's the great physician?
Christ.
Yeah. We're not following Christ. If we continue in these habits, if any man will come after me, Christ says, let him deny himself. Next slide. We may know every doctrine there is to know. We may know the truth from inside out. But if we're neglecting to follow all the counsels of God, we're going to be among the number. He says, depart from me, I never knew you. The children of God cannot glorify him with sickly bodies or dwarfed minds. Those who indulge in any species of intemperance, either in eating or drinking, waste their physical energies, and weaken moral power. Transgression of physical law is a transgression of God's law. I can't begin to explain how wonderful this body is. I cannot explain. But he has written his finger's inside of us. He's written everything inside of us. We are more complex than a computer. And I don't care how much information they got. This body can heal itself. God designed it to heal itself by putting the right things in it and continue keeping that relationship with him.
Amen.
Okay, next slide. I like this one because she says, all should have an intelligent knowledge of the human frame, which I'm guilty, I don't know it all, okay? I really do not. That they may keep their bodies in the condition necessary to do the work of the Lord. And those who form habits that weaken the nerve power and lessen the vigor of mind or body makes themselves inefficient for the work God has given to them to do. On the other hand, a pure, helpful life is most favorable for the perfection of Christian character and for the development of the powers of mind and body. The world wants to develop the mind and body, but God is saying, I want to develop your Christian character. This is why I want you to do that. That's the difference between our health message and the world's health message. They don't care about, was it you, Janet, that told me the witches they're very healthy.
And they're vegetarian.
So Satan has his health message also. And the medical missionary work is the other component I believe is missing. Brother Jackson said to us in class one day, Thomas Jackson is the director of a MEAT ministry, it's a medical missionary school. And he said in class, you will not receive the seal of God unless you're doing the medical missionary work. And we all looked at him like he was crazy, okay, because we didn't understand. But he said it, and it intrigued me, so I started studying for myself. And about a week or so later, I went back to him and said, Brother Jackson, I think I understand. The medical missionary work is the second piece of armor that we're missing. True medical missionary work is of a heavenly origin. It's not man-made. It came from heaven. It was not originated by any person who lives. But in connection with this work, we see so much which dishonors God that I'm instructed to say the medical missionary work is of a divine origin and has a most glorious mission to fulfill. It's from God. He put it in the brain. Remember we're talking about compassion and love? That one thing, is it altruism? That's where you help somebody even though you may get hurt. That's how far you would go. And that reminded me of Christ. I mean, we're the ones that hurt him. But him and the Father were so benevolent that it hurt the Father to give his Son for us to die. Now, why do we continue to do these things knowing that we're causing God to be sad? I mean, I don't understand it. When I see it, when I'm traveling, I just don't understand it anymore. Okay, next slide. The missionary work cannot be separated from the gospel. Genuine medical missionary work is bound up and separately with the keeping of God's commandments, of which the Sabbath is especially mentioned. It is a great memorial of God's creative work. Its observance is bound up with the work of restoring the moral image of God and man. This is a ministry which God's people are to carry forward at this time. This ministry rightly performed will bring rich blessings to the church. If we're wondering why we don't have anybody coming to church, and I'm not talking about Seventh-day Adventists, because Seventh-day Adventists say, oh, our church is growing, It's not growing. You got people transferring from one Adventist church to the other Adventist church. They like the music over here. They didn't like the music over there. And I'm serious. That happens in Huntsville, Alabama all the time. That's what they do. There's no people off the street that are coming. It's mainly other Seventh-day Adventists. Saving truth for this time. The medical missionary work is saving truth for this time. He designs that the medical missionary work should prepare the way for the presentation of the saving truth for this time, the proclamation of the third angel's message. How does medical missionary work do this? You got to remember what medical missionary work is. What is it? No, but what exactly is it? What is
gospel in practice.
Gospel in practice, but give me the specifics. It's in Isaiah 58. Yeah, if you read Isaiah 58, 6 and 7, it tells you what the medical missionary work is. clothing the naked, feeding the poor, and it's the same language that God uses in Matthew 25. When I was hungry, you didn't feed me. When I was naked, you didn't clothe me. Those are the ones that got cast away. The other ones said, Lord, when did we do that? Because they weren't doing it out of any selfish motive. They were doing it because of the love of God. But in order to give the third angel's message, you have to reach the people like Christ did. And you reach, they may have barriers up. They don't want to hear anything about no Sabbath. But if you become friends, like Hassana and Chris, Hassana invited a girl to the house to bake bread. She's establishing a relationship like Christ did. When the relationship is established, then the person's like, well, why are you doing this? Because I love you.
And she was like, oh, bread without butter? She kept telling her friends, bread without butter is so good.
Hassana says bread without butter was so good. But that's what we have to do. That's what, and then we can present the saving truth. You establish a relationship by befriending. And then you can talk to them about the three angels' message. Next slide. I only have about 1 minute here. Our commission. Why has it not been understood from the Word of God, not from Ellen White, but from God's Word, that the work being done in the Medical Missionary Alliance is the fulfillment of Scripture? Here we go. Go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city and bring in hither the Seventh-day Adventist people. No, you bring in the poor and the maimed and the halt and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as I have commanded, and yet there is room. And they go out and do more. This is a work that the churches in every locality, north and south and east and west, should do. The churches have been given the opportunity of answering this work. Why have they not done it? Someone must fulfill the commission. This is what I was talking about, I was opening up doors. The right hand is used to open doors to which the body may find an entrance. This is the part the medical missionary work is to act. It is to largely prepare the way for the reception of truth for this time. A body without hands is useless, right? If you don't have your hands, it's going to be kind of hard with the body. In giving honor to the body, honor must also be given to the helping hands, which are agencies of such importance that without them, the body can do nothing. And Chris, I want you to skip to a couple, one other slide. Keep, I want to get to one. Yeah, caution to the leaders. The leaders need to know this, because there's no excuse. All through this country, a work must be done that has not yet been done. The medical missionary work must be recognized. And she says, those men who, after many years' experience, have yet to appreciate the medical missionary work should not be appointed to preside over our churches. We wouldn't have any pastors, because I don't see too many doing it. I really don't. But we need to step up the plate and be able to do it. The next one. The medical missionary work is also to develop our character. She says it was given to prove, God gave it to prove his people and to develop their true character. And when you help somebody else, it gets you out of your selfishness. That's why he gave it to us, because we're selfish. But when you start helping somebody else, your selfishness goes away, and then your blessings will come, because God has a promise also in Isaiah 58. When you're helping somebody else, then your health will improve. And you know what? Research establishes that, because people that volunteer, they get better from helping somebody else. Consequences. We're coming to the end. Matthew 25, you heard me talking about it. Well, now we want to bring Christ into our everyday life. Those who had not fed the hungry, or clothed the naked, or visited the sick, were not conscious of it. And why? Because they had educated and trained themselves in the school of self-indulgence. And the result was a lost heaven and the eternity of bliss, which they might have had had they devoted their powers to God. That's where we are. I think it's one more. I like this quote. I really, truly, truly like this quote, because I think this is Gabriel. I cannot say for sure, but an angel appeared to Sister White. Said the angel, Jesus has nearly finished his work in the sanctuary. It is no time to be stupid now. A quick work will the Lord do upon the earth. The four angels will soon let go the four winds. Said the angel, beware how thou treadest enchanted ground all around the east and the west, north and south. If Satan can get thee to slumber now, he is sure of his prey. And he's got us slumbering. And he uses the food, and the music and the TV, everything that he can to destroy this mind of ours. But we don't have to be destroyed. The choice is yours. It's an individual choice. And we should not stop loving each other because some of us have decided we want to follow this plan, God's plan. You're going to get resistance from those who are your friends because maybe they're being convicted and they don't want to do it. But you don't stop loving your friends and you don't stop praying for them and you don't set yourself up as judge. But my prayer for you today is we are this close to going home. And we're still wrapped up in these worldly things. And God says, I need you as my witnesses.
Amen.
But you got to give everything to me so I can bring you back to where you used to be because I want to restore you back into my image. Let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your thoughts today. And I realize, Lord, I have been guilty of these things. And each one has to examine their own hearts to see where they stand before you. But Lord, I'm so thankful that you're revealing these things to us because we don't want to be in Satan's snare. Father, we have a better life to go to. We can't even imagine what heaven is going to look like on the new earth. And we don't want to be lost. So Father, give us the strength not only to overcome Satan, but Lord, give us the strength even more to love you more than ourselves. And we thank you, Father, in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen.